Appeals to order. A little bit of housekeeping in addition to the other housekeeping. Tonight's meeting of the Zoning Board of Appeals is being recorded for RCTV Live, Comcast Channel 22, or Verizon Channel 33. The videographer for tonight's meeting is Ben. Check rctv.org for more information and for replay times. All right, we're going to take some cases. I think we're going to take the cases out of order from the way that they're listed on the agenda tonight. We'll hear the continuation of case 1702 first. And I'll go ahead and, just for the sake of keeping the record straight, read that into the record. We're hearing a case 1702 is called continuation of a public hearing in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on Thursday, July 6th, 2017, at 7 p.m. on the petition of David Vivalecchia, who seeks a variance under Section 6.0, Table 6.3 of the zoning bylaws in order to add an addition of 29 by 6 feet by 24.3 feet, a garage to the left side with a setback of 10 feet rather than the required 15 feet as per a plan on the property located at 271 Franklin Street, Reading, Massachusetts. Reminding all that that we've already read the procedural order. Anybody that wishes to speak on the case, except Mr. Vivalecchia, you've already been placed under oath. If there are any other persons here that think they may want to speak on this case, testimony is taken under oath, so please raise your right hand to be sworn. Hearing none, we will go ahead and open the floor to Mr. Vivalecchia.
Thank you. Good evening. At our last CBA meeting on April the 20th, seems like it is a while ago, of this year, I heard four areas of concern expressed by members of the ZBA board. As I heard, the areas of concern and or issue with our original submission were an incomplete site plan. The site plan did not adequately reflect requirements for a property where a portion of the property falls within the aquifer protection district. We would like to also note that neither the existing structure or any proposed structure is constructed or would be constructed within the limits of the aquifer protection district as shown in tax map 51 on the town's website. Two, demonstration of hardship as it relates to moving the proposed structure to an alternate location on the property, i.e. the east side or the right side of the property if facing the house from the street. Three, demonstration of no detriment to the public good, i.e. maintaining the character and the consistency of other homes in the neighborhood. And four, concern of the proposed size of the structure. In addressing the board's concern, we submitted a package of supplemental materials back towards the end of May, which I assume you've had time to review at this time. If it pleases the board, I will go through the materials that were included in that and explain what was included in that package.
Please do.
Try to address the four areas. So number one, a modified site plan that's in the package dated May 31st was prepared by my engineer, submitted and reviewed and accepted by the building inspector as meeting the requirements for a home with a portion of the property falling within the aquifer protection district. So it included all the necessary percentages and all the other information that is required for a home where part of the property falls within the aquifer protection district. Two, an alternate site plan B was prepared by my engineer depicting the proposed structure on the eastern side or right side of the property, which was a concern by one of the members of the board. This configuration, as depicted, would require an additional $100,000 in site costs, as well as resulting in a very unappealing site due to the construction of a massive retaining wall that would be required, as well as the removal of several mature trees. As I explained earlier, the property has some serious grade issues, and putting the structure anywhere else in the property would require a tremendous amount of site and probably make it very unappealing. Would make it very unappealing. Three, we researched and found three examples of neighboring properties near 271 Franklin Street where garage additions and or expansions were performed. The result of these modifications resulted in two-car garages that do not conform to the town's required side yard setback of 15 feet. And I included the examples in that package as well. And lastly, on the size of the structure, to address the concern of the size of the proposed garage addition, we looked at the ratio of the same three properties of garage to total house ratio. And the ratios of 21%, 31%, and 26% were achieved when looking at the percentage of garage footprint to the total footprint of the house and garage. Our proposed ratio depicted in the variance application proposes 22%. So we try to address all the concerns. We hope we have made a compelling enough case for this board to grant us the variance as we requested, but I would be happy to answer any other questions. That's all I have this evening.
Great, thanks very much. Before we go to any board comments, I'd like to read into the record comments from the building inspector, Glenn Redman. We've had a couple of sets since we were delayed from our June 1 meeting because of the fire. We have a memo from Glenn Redman to us dated May 31st. It says, regarding the plot plan, dated May 31st, 2017, this new revised plot plan does indicate the size of the garage and does contain the impervious calculations. The requirements of the recharge system will be addressed prior to the issuance of a building permit if the ZBA does in fact grant the requested variance. There was an earlier May 30th email from Glenn Redman to the board, which were addressed by the May 31st one, but to make sure it goes in the record. Dimensions of the proposed garage not indicated, assume they are the same, which was addressed in the May 31st. Second page with impervious calculations and lot coverage indicated on the plot plan, which the May 31st submission did. And the recharge design will have to be eventually approved by the town engineer prior to a building permit if the ZBA grants the variance. There was a most recent note sent to us today from Glenn, case 1702. This is a continuance. A new plot plan has been submitted. The recharge system has been submitted to engineering for their approval. So those are our comments from Glenn, the zoning enforcement officer, building inspector. And I think what I'd like to do is now ask for board comments. We could start down the end with Nick.
All right, so I remember, I think it's April, when you first came to us, I saw there was a lot of potential of a justified variance in this when you were talking about the sub pump in the basement, the ledge potential, the mature trees. And I think that you've definitely done your homework, and I see that you have a cost estimate from an engineer stamp showing the, you know, almost $106,000 to put the garage on the right side of the house as opposed to the left. So I just thank you for providing those numbers. It's really good to see the concrete numbers on paper of the hardship that that would bring. Other than that, I don't have any comments.
Great. Robert.
Thank you. Yeah, it looks like he's adequately, the applicant has adequately addressed the stormwater issue there in regards to recharge of the groundwater systems. I'm still having issues with a new nonconformity on the garage, the 10-foot offset rather than the 15-foot there from the sideline. It's a single-car garage, right? Mm-hmm. And I think it's an oversized single-car garage. Obviously, I think you could fit two cars in here, and I think if you even kicked it back 5 feet to meet the side yard setback, you could probably put two cars in stacked. I'm not saying they'd be side by side, but you could fit two in stacked. The length of the garage is, what, 23 and a half plus six? It's almost 30 feet long, the garage. So I think you could fit two cars in stacked if you had to. So that's what I'm having issues with, is the request for the variance and the new nonconformity there on the side yard.
Right. Yeah. Thank you, Robert. John?
I'll pass at this point.
Sai.
Well, when we reviewed this thing back in April, the only real problem I had was the size and creating a new nonconformity that you could easily, I think, comply with the 15 feet and still have a pretty decent sized garage. I don't know when the 15-foot setback came into the bylaws. three references you make to the other properties in the area. I think every one of those was granted back in the 80s.
30 years ago.
May I address the board?
I don't know when. Does any, John, do you know when the 15-foot setback came into?
We'll give you an opportunity. Okay. Thank you.
I believe I went to the town clerk and looked at some of the old bylaws, and I think it was 2002, and it was, the difference was a 10-foot setback if it was a detached, if it was an attached garage. Detached still had to be 15 feet.
Okay.
The attached aspect of it went to 15 feet, the same as the detached, about 2002.
So if you went back to those cases that you were referring to.
They were legal at the time.
They were legal at the time.
Legal at the time, yes.
Okay, all right. Because I get the impression that you've done a lot of work, and I congratulate you for really putting some effort into this whole thing. But
hasn't been inexpensive.
Huh?
It hasn't been inexpensive.
No. I know that.
It's cost me a lot of money.
But, you know, I think trying to use those three cases as precedent setting for something like this may not be on the mark. So I'll kind of sit back and just take the position at the moment that I still have a concern about the size. Okay?
All right, before we go on to Eric, we'll give the applicant a chance to.
So I did. Obviously, those three additions were done in the 80s. I went back and I looked at the zoning bylaws where every change in the zoning bylaws has to be noted. I didn't find any notification of any change in the setback prior to, subsequent to that date. So I'm not sure what the 2002 date is.
What disappeared in 2002 was the difference between detached and attached garages to the home. And about 2002, probably done in 2001, but not given permission to go into existence until the Attorney General passed on it, which I think was 2002.
There's nothing dated and there's nothing outlined.
No, it isn't. You have to go back and research all the bylaws.
Am I not correct that that has to be noted in that ZBA bylaws?
It is.
That's what my consultant told me.
Let me clarify. There are different bylaws. There's a bylaw that existed prior to 2002 that had one version of the bylaw.
Right.
There's the updated bylaw in 2002 has the wording and the verbiage for the new version of the bylaw.
Okay.
The changes are probably detailed somewhere outside of the zoning bylaw where a town meeting would have had to vote on it. There was probably a warrant article at town meeting taken up with regard to the proposed language changes, and likely there is a voluminous file somewhere about how that was researched and put together and how it came to be that was a proposed bylaw change.
Can I ask the question at that time, was there a 10-foot setback in place at that time?
For attached.
For detached, there was
15.
Still a 15.
Okay, so there's an example in here of a 7-foot setback. That still was outside of the 10-foot setback at that point.
That was a variance that was granted.
So there was a variance for a 7-foot setback that was provided.
Yes.
At that time. So, I mean, there is precedent there.
So it was going by his example, it was a 3-foot variance because it was legal to be 10 feet,
mm-hmm.
and the encroachment was 3 feet into the setback. A variance was granted for a 3-foot encroachment.
And you had to read the case to find out why,
right?
Which I'm not going to get into right now.
Was there
justification for that particular variance at that particular time?
30 years ago, 30 plus.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So just trying to give it some context to make sure that we don't read it in a vacuum and understand the circumstances. Okay. Eric,
I mean, obviously, with each variance, it's case by case. So each lot is, you know, unique in its own way. I think that to have a single car garage be, you know, 24 feet wide, I don't know if that rises to the level of needing a variance. So that's my general feeling on that. But the issue that I had before, you've neutralized with, you know, why can't we put it on the other side? So kudos to you for that. I think the only thing that I'm left with is the proportions. So that's it.
All right, thanks. You know, I've had an opportunity last time we were here, and since last time we were here, I've taken a look at the well thought out supplemental package that was brought in, and again, I echo the other board members in that there has been a lot of information submitted to the board to support this application, you know, that is, respectfully, that's impressive. The grounds for granting a variance require four criteria. We've gone through them. One is the unique shape and topography of the property. We have the, looking at it from the street, the right-hand side of the property that you've indicated is not a good place for it, and you've indicated the reasons why. And I'm looking at it at that criteria from the theoretical and the use of the land, or the inability to fully use the land the way you want to, is technically not, it walks a fine line according to the case law regarding the meeting of the first criteria. The criteria with regard to the, you know, the sort of substantial derogation of the zoning bylaw, this board has historically, at least as long as I've been on it, and maybe those that have been on it longer than I have, on the board longer than I have, might also echo this. Where we are, as you can hear, the board typically struggles with applications that substantially increase an already non-conforming structure. And so that's where we get into the substantial derogation of the zoning bylaw. It's a large structure. It is both in height and width. The height of the property, I was out to the property before the last time we met, and having a look at it and taking a look at the drawings, the proposed roof of the structure, the tip of the roof goes up to the top of your second floor window, so which is about 3 or 4 feet away from your roof line on the original dwelling, the home itself. It is a sizable structure that's somewhat imposing at the street level view, and that also cuts into, I think, the substantial derogation in that, you know, as the, for lack of a better term, eyes and ears of the town, we also are charged with making sure that the structure, as large as it is and imposing as it is not imposing upon the town, the public, those driving by, those that have to see it, you have to live in it. And that's fine for you, and we want you to be able to utilize your property. But as the eyes and ears of the town, we also have to keep in mind in that it almost coupled with a substantially detrimental to the neighborhood character aspect that we handle when we're dealing with special permits, where we get into the substantial derogation argument. So I'm troubled by the size of it. You know, you've done a great job demonstrating your compliance with the Aquifer Protection District, complying with the you know, the dolls and cents of it. I get, and there's no denying that there's a I'll recognize you in a moment. I see you want to speak.
Enough.
There is a sizable difference in what it would cost you to build the current structure where it is, as opposed to trying to build it somewhere else, okay, or in another proposed location. So it's, you know, it's a, arguably it's not an easy decision. It's not an easy application. It's not as cut and dry. They rarely are. As we would like it to see, and you've heard some board comment. You had a comment.
So your comment to the architecture. I mean, let's call it what it is, the architecture. So that what was prepared for this was more just to get an idea. We, you know, my wife and I, we don't consider ourselves to be to like unappealing things. We have a designer, someone who will design something that will look nice, unlike the house that was just constructed up the road that is looks extremely ugly, that I know probably didn't go in front of this board, but is an imposing structure that is ugly. But that's another story. So we're not into making our house look ugly, I can guarantee you that, or make it look unappealing to the neighborhood. So, I mean, I could give my word to the board that whatever is done, if such a variance is granted, will be appealing, because personally, I don't want to live in something that doesn't look good, and I wouldn't, you know, and I wouldn't do that to my neighbors, or for my resale value. That would be kind of dumb. So, you know, for whatever it's worth, that is just done as a given idea of the structure on the property. That wasn't done by an architect. It was basically done by someone like myself to just kind of throw something on there to get an idea of the structure and the size. So, I mean, that's all I can say to that. We do have an architect, but we're obviously not going to engage somebody like that until, you know, you have something more definitive to go with. It would be kind of throwing some more money down the toilet.
Certainly, it's not my intention or the intention of this board to call your house ugly. That's not what I mean.
No, I don't take it that way. I take it as the proposed addition would be unappealing, as depicted. And I agree. It doesn't look that great in the drawing.
Perhaps imposing might be a good word. And it can be built with the finest materials, the highest quality paint, shingles, trim, really expensive garage door with all the bells and whistles that everybody likes to have in a garage door. And that's beautiful. Aesthetically, material-wise, it's very well built. It's large. It's 10 feet off the street, the door of the garage, 10 feet off the street.
It's not closer than the existing house. It's set back 2 feet.
Right, but it's almost a doubling of the length of your house, almost the same size as your house. And so that's what I'm struggling
with. That's not all garage.
The size of it.
That 6 feet of that is mudroom entryway.
Right.
That's not all garage.
Right. And so
because it can't work that way because of the chimney, if you remember. It has to be bumped out.
Right.
And it'd be a waste to not utilize that space for something for
good use of space.
Right. So it's not all garage is what I'm saying. It's an extension of the house and then garage.
Right. I understand. I don't have anything further. Did you want to chime in? We left you out last time. So go ahead, John, please.
Well, first of all, we're here because you're requesting a variance. And as a long-term member of the board, I can tell you that the way back when the ratio of variances granted by the Board of Appeals, Redding Zoning Board of Appeals, was probably one in every six or eight that came through the door. And they had to meet the specific criteria, the four criteria. And the two most difficult criteria to meet were the first two. One was the topography, and the second one was the hardship relative to the changes that you want to make by granting the variance. And in looking at this, you didn't put a lot of emphasis on Plan B in our first hearing. And you came back with an option with Plan B. Plan B is an option. You can do that. The board looks at if that is possible, which it appears to be possible, costly, but possible, then that is an option without granting a variance, but you could still get what you want as desired, not the same format, but the same result. Second is the aspect of the cost factor. The cost factor is not really discussed. It is not part of the 40A aspect in description. It does not come into discussion. Yes, it's $100,000 more expensive, but that's not part of it. So, to me, it looks like we don't have to go with Plan A, because Plan A, Plan B is still an option. You can get what you want. Unfortunately, it's going to be more costly. So we don't need a variance for Plan A. Another option for you to do, has been mentioned by the other members of the board, is just to shrink it so that it meets the criteria of the 15-foot setback. That's creation of a number of things. Either instead of going 30 feet deep because your property line is not parallel with the line of the structure that you want to raise or put up, by bringing that forward, you're reducing the encroachment on that 15-foot side setback, and by shrinking it a little bit on the side, instead of 24 feet, you're shrinking it to possibly 22 feet, which is still a sizable. I don't have the dimensions. I didn't work it out. I didn't sit down and work it out. But I think if you brought that forward and moved it in about, I'm guessing, about 2 feet, you would meet the 15-foot setback on that, northwesterly corner of the garage. So in each case, you would not have to be before this board. You could move to the building inspector, give them the size and plans, you meet the requirements of zoning, and you can put up what you need to put up, as long as you meet his criteria. But to me, you have not met the first two criteria. Even if I can get past 3 and 4, you have not met the first two criteria. So
I disagree, but because financial hardship is one of the, I mean, it is financial or otherwise, no? It isn't?
It is. The financial hardship is not the major criteria. The financial criteria is by not granting the variance, you are hindered from making use of your property to the point that it is impinging upon your right.
So how could I ever meet that? I mean, that's subjective, right?
That's what 40A is.
So, in theory, you could never approve something, right?
That's not true.
I was handicapped and needed
conservation, for example, you have a wetland. You can't come in any closer to the wetland. You have an outcropping of ledge that you'd have to blast to get through. Those are two immediate environmental issues. Right now, we have a third, which we don't even see here because it hasn't come back from the engineers.
Ledge,
that's the aquifer protection district.
Ledge is solvable. I mean, blast it. It costs money. I'm just curious to the whole process. I've never been through it, obviously.
Well, the natural features, too.
You know, there's, all I know is my property, there's about, you know, well over a third of the property that's just unusable because of grade issues. And unfortunately, the structure, the property lines are what they are. And I understand the size of it. The size of it is not, this isn't just a car. It is one car. We don't have any storage, if you remember correctly. My basement, half of my basement's on slab. The house has been constructed a million different times. We're trying to make it look normal. You know, we're trying to have a normal, and we're trying to have some storage area for my kids and my wife and everything else, you know, for all the stuff that we do. It doesn't seem excessive to me. I understand it can seem excessive to you, but I guess for us, it isn't, because I guarantee you, I'd like to get rid of a shed because I don't want to have two sheds on my property. You know, I want something for the lawnmower, and I don't want to have to store all the other junk in there and make it look unsightly. So it's if I can go bigger, I go bigger, believe me, because I know we'd fill it. But the thing about it is we don't have storage, and our basement is unusable, period. That's all that is. So I'll build another shed. I mean, that's all I can do.
So
no, there's other things that you can do.
It's
you're talking about building a 30-foot addition to the front of your house, most of which in the front is the garage plus the entryway, you call a mudroom. You have a second floor on top of that. That is a substantial increase in the size, which this board is not caring about, except for the fact that you're encroaching 5 feet into, which is 33%, into the setback requirement for side lot lines. I'm just throwing out you, just throwing to you some suggestions.
I'm just assuming that the side setback had to do with the other structures nearby were close proximity. I mean, there's still good, even if we put this, there's still going to be a good 50 feet in between structures. I mean, so aesthetically.
50 feet?
Oh, easily.
It can't be 50 feet. It's only 5 feet. It's 10 feet now from your proposal to the side lot line. How is that 50 feet?
To the next house I'm talking about.
What if the next house decides that they want to put up a structure too and come within? Then 10
feet.
How do we do that? That's what 40A is there to protect. It's protecting everybody. And the whole issue with the 40A regulations is that if this board or any board grants that petition within 21 days, anybody can come in, challenge it, it will go to court, guarantee you will lose. This board will also be slapped in the hand, not that that's an issue because we've been slapped in the hand before, but you'll lose because you don't meet the criteria. But that's up, and you'll spend 2 years minimum in court trying to get through there. So if you want to...
I'll take the gamble because I know my neighbors are in support because I'm friends with all of them.
Today.
And they are in support.
Today.
So I
take that gamble.
Okay.
Our mandate here is to consider whether the application presented to the board meets the statutory criteria. Our board takes it upon itself to offer suggestions, but we're here to determine whether the application presented to us, the option, if you will, presented to us, meets the statutory criteria, not whether it's the most desirable option. It's whether or not what's been presented meets the four criteria. So while we often do try to offer the benefit of experience and offer suggestions, that's not our mandate with regard to a variance application. I cut you short. Did you have anything?
No, I was.
Okay.
I was.
All right. Your point's well taken, and I think echoes other things that other board members have alluded to or directly said. Are there any other board members that, following up on that, have anything to say?
Yeah, just a couple of comments.
Go ahead, Si.
I'm not insensitive to the precedents that appears to might have been set by the three prior cases, okay? Setting aside even the thought process of what the bylaws said back then vis-a-vis what they say now, and just look at it from the standpoint of what your place is going to look like with this and its setback compared to the other properties with the setbacks that are very similar, okay? I can sensitize to that, and I can see where you're coming from. But the case that you haven't made to me is, why do you need such a sized garage that you've got in the plan right now? Because there's, as has been said, there are things you can do if you think through that whole thing. You could make that garage such that you wouldn't be here. Answer for me, why do you feel you need such a large garage to start with? Why?
Because I think a good portion of it's being taken up by the entryway, the mudroom area.
Well, take that out of it. It's still a pretty good sized garage.
We have a chimney that juts out 2 feet into that, on that side of the house. I'm not going to take down, move it, fireplace and chimney and all that. The 16-foot garage door, I mean, we're going to be able to get an SUV. We do a lot of stuff as a family, and we have a lot of, the kids have a lot of sport. There's a lot of bikes, there's a lot of kayaks, there's all kinds of stuff that we need to store, and we don't have an accessible basement as an alternative for this. So it's I guess it's, I understand. Trust me, I get what you're saying. It's not that I don't. I mean, I think I'm logical, but I know our needs. And if you lay it out, we need space. We need space. And I mean, trust me, I'd like to throw it all out often a lot of times, but that's not realistic. You know, it just isn't. And so it's, I guess it's our lifestyle. It's the things that we do, things that we like to do, things the kids like to do. There's a requirement there. Do we have to have it? I mean, could you live without it? Yeah, we're living without it right now. But is it something that would make our lives, you know, improve it? Would they improve the property, improve our situation on the property, you know, in our lives? Yes, it would. It would be, you know, so I could live in my shed if I had to. I mean, there's lots of things I could do. But my wife would like me to live in the shed sometimes, I think, too. So am I on the record on that? She'll agree.
I don't know if the town would. I would expect you might have something to say about that.
All right, we'll open it up to a public comment section. Anybody want to say anything about the application before us? Hearing none, we'll close the public comment section. I think we've talked it through, so I guess, all right, so, you know, what we typically do is, you've heard what the board has to say. The board has given you as many comments in as many different ways as I think we know how, to let you know where the board members think your application presents shortcomings, perhaps. That said, you've been patient, you've been diligent, and you're here tonight. And this board can vote on your application tonight. A upvote gives you your variance. Required 4 out of 5, 5 senior members. We'll call Eric a senior member for the purposes of voting. A downvote bars you for 2 years from doing anything with your property that is substantially similar to the request that you've made in this application. That said, it is your right and our duty to provide you with a vote, if you want one, on your application. Yeah. And that's what you're here for tonight. And you'd like the board to vote on the application that you presented.
Yeah,
exactly. Right?
I've gone this far.
You've been fair with us, and I want to be fair with you. All right. Any other board commentary? Anything? No. All right. We'll take a motion. Somebody want to make a motion on this application? Euler, Cy, how about you make a motion?
Well, thank you. I've been here for a long time.
Come on.
Okay. I move to grant the petitioner, David Vivalecchia.
Yeah. Excellent.
Excellent. A variance under section 6, table 6.3 of the zoning bylaw, in order to add a 20, I think I got the dimension right, 29.6 feet by 24.3 feet garage on the left side of the property with a setback of 10 feet rather than the required 15 feet required by the bylaw on the property located at 271 Franklin Street in Reading. In accordance with a plot plan dated, and I think it's 5/31/17, prepared and certified by Christopher Novak, professional engineer, and photographs included with the application. Standard conditions apply to this, which I will summarize. Petitioner shall submit to the building inspector a certified plot plan of the proposed construction.
That's a special permit, sorry.
That's a special permit? You're right. We don't have any conditions for variance, do we?
Well, I mean, we can condition.
The only condition I would add to this thing, then, would be the condition that the town engineer approve the recharge design
exactly
before issuing a building permit. Mm-hmm. I guess that's the only condition that would apply to this.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
You have a second?
Second.
Second by Eric. Okay, Any further discussion? Okay, hearing none. All those in favor of the application? All those opposed? 5-0-0 in the negative. Sorry, sir, your variance does not carry.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you for your time. Mm-hmm. Next hearing on the agenda tonight is case 1705. Excuse me, we'll read the notice. Public hearing in the Selectman's Meeting Room at Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on Thursday, July 6, 2017, at 7 p.m. on the petition of Alyssa and Evan Gallegos, who seek a special permit under sections 532 and 5472 of the zoning bylaws in order to construct an addition 36 by 46 and to alter the interior of the existing dwelling for the purpose of an accessory apartment on the property located at 320 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts. Unless there's an objection, I'll dispense with the reading of the abutters list, except to say that the abutters were notified, as were the appropriate boards and commissions in Reading, and members and associate members of the Board of Appeals, as well as the planning boards of the abutting communities. Testimony given before this board is taken under oath, so if you think you're going to speak on this application, please stand and raise your right hand. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. The response is I do.
I do.
Thank you. When you wish to speak, other than the applicant, obviously, please identify yourself by name and address for the record. Okay? That said, we'll open the floor to the applicant.
My name is Alyssa Anderson. Gallegos. Oh my goodness, I'm going back. This is my husband, Evan Gallegos. I grew up here in Reading, and we've moved all around the country. My husband was an Air Force pilot, and so we've moved our family around. And about a little bit over a year ago, we had the opportunity to move back to Reading, actually back up to New England. And in conversation with my parents, I was saying I wanted a town with good schools, and I wanted our children to be able to walk downtown and be in a community where they could get around and grow in their independence. And I kept going on different things. We were looking in southern New Hampshire and wasn't really finding anything. And my father said, "It sounds like you want to live in Reading." And I said, "I think we really do." And so they're at the point in their life where they were ready to kind of downsize but not move into an apartment or anything. They have really no desire to ever do that. And we thought it was the perfect opportunity to put an accessory apartment on for them and live together. He's a pilot, and he's gone 2 weeks every month. I'm teaching, and so it just worked really well for all of us to live together, for them to help with the children, and as they get older, for us to help with them. My son's already taken over the responsibilities of mowing the lawn and those kinds of things, so they don't have those burdens. And so with that, about 14 months ago, we started to do all of our research. We met with the wetland scientist, and we got approval because we do back up to conservation land. We received approval from the Aquifer Protection District as well, with plans to put in two dry wells so that we make sure that we have the right amount of coverage for water runoff. We worked with the architect to create plans that will, it was really important to me and my sisters as we went ahead to do this, that the house remained looking like a one family home. Even coming back to Reading and seeing some things, you know, it's been different for me, and I love the way Reading was when I left it. And so the house needs some updates. It, you know, a lot of things, you know, just it's time for things to be replaced and updated, and so this is the perfect opportunity to do that. But with plans with the architect, we were really involved in making sure that it looks seamless, that their entryway is on the side. It was a two-car garage, for four cars, and we've worked it so the parking won't, we don't want a parking lot. We love a lot of space, which is why we love this property. It has a nice big sledding hill in the back for our children and that I used as well. And so it was really important for us to keep a lot of green space, but make it safe and work because it is on a busy part of Lowell Street. And so that really is really what I wanted to share with you, I think, of why we're doing this. So we all get along and want to make this work. And for 14 months, we've been living together in this three-bedroom Cape. And so it's something that it's really important to all of us to do. And it's been really nice for our kids. It's their only grandchildren here in Massachusetts. So it's just been really great.
And we both work, so with the lack of a bus system and crossing Lowell Street, to get to the elementary school for our youngest two. It was also very beneficial to be co-located and to have the help and the support to take them to and from school some days when I'm not home. So
we're happy to answer any questions that you have. Mm-hmm. And we have our builder, Rich Bova, and my parents are here as well.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So typically what we do after this point, you can go, yeah, you can get us. Mm-hmm. Typically what we'll do at this point is allow board members to offer any comments or questions after having reviewed the application and the supporting materials. But actually, before I do that, we do have, I'd like to read into the record the a letter, note that we got, email that we got today from the building inspector regarding daytime government's thoughts and the building inspector's thoughts on your application. Case 1705, 320 Lowell Street, dated July 6, 2017. I quote, I have reviewed the construction plans for 320 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. For the proposed addition and the accessory apartment. The plan is somewhat cut up and not simple to calculate the square footage areas. The following calculations are what I have determined from the proposed plan dated construction set April 24, 2017. And the building inspector, without going through all of the various calculations, calculates the current single family at 2909 square feet with the proposed existing first floor, proposed second floor of 2,909 square feet with a proposed accessory apartment dimensions totaling 1,003 square feet. So from reading the bylaw and his calculations, he comes up with an allowable area totaling 960 square feet, which is 2,909 square feet times 0.33, a third, which is under the zoning bylaw, it has to be a third or less coverage. And that comes out to 960 square feet. And the calculations that I just mentioned that the building inspector calculated in the proposed dwelling is 1,003 square feet. And so the building inspector opines that the accessory apartment area seems to be slightly over the allowable area. So we'll just read that into the record, offer you an opportunity. Let's get through board comment. I think there may be others here that have some thoughts on that as well. And we'll get through that, and certainly, you know, feel free to ask to be recognized by the chair if there's anything that comes up that can't wait. All right? Thanks so much. Is there another one?
Town engineer.
Oh, that's right. You're right. There is a second. Oh, yeah, that was in our packet. There is a second opinion letter. Thank you, Robert. Dated June 27th from Ryan Percival, the town engineer, to Carol Anderson. I guess, let's see. All right, so I'll work this backwards. So June 27th, there were several back and forth emails sent to and from Carol Anderson and Ryan Percival, the town engineer, asking for, and I'll summarize, for assistance with the approval of a proper size dry well regarding the development of the accessory apartment to handle the roof runoff. The request was made to Ryan Percival at 2 o'clock, a little after 2 o'clock on June 27th, and the town engineer Ryan Percival wrote back at 5:30 that same day in response to the request from the applicant, saying, "Hi Carol, I unfortunately can neither size nor help design the recharge system required for the aquifer district. That being said, I'm happy to talk to your engineer and answer any questions. Typically, the design for the recharge system is required prior to the issuance of a building permit. The building inspector will request the town of Rennie Engineering Division to review and approve the design." And Ryan sent that over to Julie on June 27th so that it could be made part of the case record. All right. So we have the opinions of the engineer and the comments from the engineer and the building inspector. So we'll go ahead and move forward with any board comments or questions. We'll start at the other end. Eric?
Honestly, I think the only major concern I have is the calculation that Glenn lays out. I don't know if there's a way that your architect can just kind of close that gap, but I think that if you were able to do that, it wouldn't have a major problem with it. The only other thing that I think I saw in the renderings here, I don't know if there's the actual unit itself is contained. I know there's like a hallway into it. I think you would need to have like a door, a separate entry door there on that second level. I just couldn't make it out here on the plan here, but I mean, I think if you were to have it self-contained, I think those would be the two issues.
I think the applicant, I had a very difficult time reading the plan here. It's so small. Even with the magnifying glass that I had, I couldn't see the numbers. So I went in and I spoke with the building inspector, who said that there would be.
Reese, you want to have Adam?
Uh huh. I had dropped off 3 sets this week.
Got it.
Yeah. All right. So these are the full size drawings that have been provided to the town. Kim was nice to alert me to this earlier. Are there specific?
Well, I don't. What Eric is talking about now, you can look at and you can
right.
see what the.
This is on A103. And they have the.
Why don't you give that one
exactly?
Yeah, and then give one them and that everybody has.
Okay.
So they can all know what you're talking about.
Well, why don't we have it shared here then?
Do you have 2 sets, David?
Do I have 2?
I think you have 2. Right, Rich? He has 2?
All right, let's
2
see.
Sets?
Yes, they have 2 sets.
Yeah.
Julie,
all right, yep, here we go. All right, here we go.
Okay.
Take that set down there. You guys share that one.
We'll share this one.
Okay. I have another one here, David.
I think we killed enough trees up here. I think we'll be good. Thank you. All right, Eric, so your question was, what was it, A103 or
yeah.
102?
I think I'm on A103, and I guess the only thing that I want to confirm is that it's a contained area. There aren't any, open areas. Like, we've had accessory apartments where there's, this breezeway connecting it, and they don't want to disrupt the flow of traffic. But I think one of the things that the bylaws require and that the board looks for is that it's an actual self-contained, you need locking
right.
doors to enter it.
Yes.
So I guess now that I've seen it up here, I just want to confirm if that's the case here.
Is Mr. Bova here?
Yes, sir.
Yes, right here.
That's who I thought about.
Mm-hmm.
You want to explain to the board and actually to now Eric? Where that would be, the 2 means of egress?
So the first mean of egress is the right-hand side of the front door. So this porch area is a means of egress right here.
But it's on the side.
It's on the side.
So you can't see it.
It's not that door. It's you can't see the door. It's
so if you walked up the porch and you took a right heading towards the garage, it's going to be there, because we can't have the door, according to code, facing the street.
Right. So that's the locked door that leads to a stairway.
So that's the first one that they go into their own, and they have a stairway. And when they get to the top of the stairs, there's another door that enters into their accessory apartment, separate from ours. And it's all firewalled as well, separating theirs from our space.
Bear with us while we get through the.
No problem.
So one, right?
Just want to make sure that
this is the first
doors and
everything. The other main entrance is on the second.
If I came up the hallway, there would just be people like walk into the living room. You know what I mean? Like that first criteria is self-contained.
This is all part of the.
That's right.
This has been changed.
And so we've got that.
Although it's not the place.
I think John's song
is those plans are
up there.
This is something we went and saw.
Down here, through the door, then it goes up the stairs, but out in the back.
Have we educated ourselves with regard to that issue sufficiently, or do we need more input from the applicant?
And where the, thick dot line on the second floor, you can see their apartment, and there's the door that enters in to that they would have their own lock.
And that's the firewall that goes,
around it, showing you where their space is.
And so you've got the way in is through that concealed side door.
Correct,
yes.
And then the way out is through this egress deck that you've noted on this plan.
Correct, yes.
So there are two exits.
Right.
But when talking with building inspector last Thursday, he told me that he would not agree with that, but that's part of the building portion of it.
Okay.
He told you that this must be moved to the other end of the deck because they are too close to one another and become not sufficient to meet fire code.
Yeah, he let me know that.
So it should be pushed down further?
It should be pushed down to the end.
Pushed down to the end of the deck.
Okay.
But I mean, that was just that aspect.
Right. So we don't have a plan that shows that yet because it hasn't been. It's been communicated. It's not shown on the plans yet.
Correct.
Okay.
We were trying to get through the square footage this whole week. With Glenn and I were trying to get through the square footage. So the architect came up with 994. Glenn came up with 1003. I took a shot at it. I came up at 994. If you want to start adding outside wall to inside wall or inside wall to inside wall, there's a lot of jogs and jigs in it. He wasn't going to spend tons of hours on it. So he came up with 1,003. So if we want to work from the 1,003 and go back, that's his. The computer did 994, I did 994. So if you look at the plan and you want to go outside the inside, or you want to go outside, there's no outside on the other side because it's the inside of the house.
Well, as he explained to me when I was in there on Thursday, that the acceptable value from the calculations was 960. He came in by his calculations from the plant that you gave him as 1,003, which is over both of the options, which is 1/3 of the existing and the 1,000 square feet maximum that you could have in the accessory. So somehow that's got to be worked out.
Yeah. We've been working on that all week.
Yeah, we think we have a solution. Should I mention it now?
Well, unless you had a set of plans that...
Yeah, it's pretty easy to see it, though. Can I just at least show you and see if we're on the right track?
Why not?
Okay. So, within this firewall up here...
What are you still on? You're on A103? That way we can follow along on the larger scale plans that we have. Yeah, it's A103. All right, good. Just so that we're all...
So this is now in the accessory apartment on the second floor. And you can see the dark lines, which is showing the firewall for that unit. Well, if you notice, right in the middle, we have a bathroom over there. And then there's a hall to go to the bedroom beside the bathroom.
Yep, designated as hall, in between the laundry room and the bathroom.
There's an extra closet right here, and extra space here, which is like just part of the hall. So if we eliminated that and just brought it straight up, and all this space would then go into the calculation of the original house. So if you add about 35 square feet from that, from the closet and that hall space, then you're making the 2009-2043, and then you calculate a third of that, and a third of that would be under the, it would still be a third, but it would be under 1,000. I think it would be 968 or 971. So it would meet the criteria by eliminating that space and that closet, because we still have a closet in the bedroom. So that would be just...
But that's part of the proposed addition. That's not the existing structure. That's what you're proposing to build right now. That's not the way the house looks now.
Right,
that's part of your proposed
plan. But that 2,900 is proposed too.
Part of the new structure.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Yeah. Right.
So it would add.
Given the space to the house.
We're gaining that space instead.
And then the percentage is going to work. When I give that 35 square feet to the house, then the accessory is less. And my Swift and my percentage works.
And we're both under a third and we're under 1,000. So we meet those two criteria.
So it's really just doing that little bit in the middle and putting the firewall
really
straight across.
Yeah.
And
it's really up to the building inspector.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Which
yeah,
we
I mean
have
that,
to, we'd have to approve
that's
the code
a,
anyway.
If that's a proposal that you want to go over with the building inspector and draw it up and put it on a plan that the building inspector can have at, or at least go over with you,
yeah.
And the building inspector concurs with you, then we would need to see a new plan with the new dimensions so that we can see the new calculations in order to grant your application.
We're bringing a new plan regardless because we have to move the second egress. So.
Okay.
The whole issue is if this board were to grant you what you're asking, it gives you a set of plans that you have to go by. We can't go by these set of plans, so we can't grant you anything until we get a set of plans to base it on. And that's what Dave is talking about this evening. We can't, even if we want to, we can't.
We have to have a set of plans to reference.
I have to stamp a set
of
plans
decision.
To approve
yeah.
your application.
So
that set of plans goes with the board's decision, gets recorded, and is part of the package, an application, an approval package. I don't have anything to stamp, even if I wanted to.
Understand.
Been
right.
presented.
Absolutely.
I understand it's a work in progress.
Yes.
And I understand that you know, thinking out of the box is sometimes what you got to do. But the board can't vote on it tonight because we don't have the plans to vote on.
So is all square footage for all these accessory apartments in town right on? Does any of them go over by 3 square feet, 4 square feet? They're all right on?
Yes. By design.
More or less.
Or, yeah.
Well, I mean, we
that's
don't...
How,
we
that's
don't,
how Glenn looks at
right.
it.
Right. We
yeah.
don't make the final decision. The building inspector goes in...
Oh, no, I
understand.
...and
says, okay, if you meet it, I'll give you the occupancy permit. If you don't, you're going to have to cut something out.
Right.
We're not the policeman. All we are is the
yeah.
grantor of...
Right. Go ahead,
yeah. I think we're all on the same page as far as that goes. But while we're here, what we would like to, we don't want it to be a moving target, so we would also like to find out if there's anything besides the square footage that you discovered and the second, and the moving of the egress point. That way we can go back knowing what we have to change before we come back.
Mm-hmm.
So that's all we're really asking, I think, other than.
We agree with you.
Yeah. Right.
Which is, and we're
okay.
Making our way through it.
Perfect.
So the first was the location of the egress, the second was the square footage calculations, and we started with Eric. Eric discussed that. We kind of
went through it, but I like to try to keep it in order. Si.
Are you done?
I thought that was Eric's only concern. Si, do you have any questions, concerns regarding the application that the applicant can take with them?
Well, if I go back and read the building inspector's rejection, he made reference to other areas. Certified plot plan required. I think at the time he wrote his memo, he didn't have one.
Right.
But there is one.
There is one.
So that's it.
Yeah, that's here.
Mm-hmm. Act for protection compliance. I think
absolutely.
It's been stated that you've done that.
Yep. The runoff recharge system is an engineering question once they get their special permit.
And he mentioned building codes have to be met. Yes, obviously they have to be met. Okay. And he mentioned conservation approval had to be obtained too.
We've done that.
We have.
The drainage has been done and the conservation has been done.
Yeah, mm-hmm. We did.
So aside from this, what Erica applied to, I don't have anything new.
Okay. Thank you, Si. John, anything else besides the two things that we've gone over?
I have one concern, but I'll hold that concern in abeyance and listen to the rest of my.
All right. Being cryptic. Okay. Robert?
Well, okay. First of all, I think this is exactly what the accessory apartment bylaw is for, this particular situation with in-laws moving in and combining the families. So I think it's perfect for that. But I do have my concerns, as the building inspector did, with the calculations for the areas. And I think you're going to have to meet with the building inspector and come to an agreement on, your accessory apartment and your principal structure on that. The only other issue I had when I was looking through the criteria here, and there are, A through K there in the zoning bylaw, the criteria, was D, which is the appearance, that the appearance must be kept as a single-family home, like that, and that there should only be one entrance, front entrance on it. There shouldn't be two separate entrances, one to the apartment, one to the principal structure on the front of the building. Now, I look at it, and you're going to have the two structures. You maintain, the existing house is being maintained, correct?
Yes.
And that door is being maintained.
So the second door that you see in the plans enter into a space for us.
Okay.
So it's an entryway with a half bath and a small family room in the back. So we're extending our home, too, because it's a 1,600 square foot existing home right now.
Yeah.
And so we have boys and girls. When we grew up in the home, it was three girls with three bedrooms. So we're actually trying to make it work by, in the existing bedroom right now is not like really livable space. So our son has a twin bed in this space. So we're adding, we're taking the bedroom, we're making the study a bedroom so that we have an extra family space. So that entryway is like a breezeway to the garage that's for our home. So it'd be like a side door, if that makes sense. So that's...
Can I show you? We have like a 3D.
Okay. That'd be
crazy about these.
Yeah, anything, because I look at the plans and I go...
So that second door that you see...
Two entrances in the front.
Right.
This would be the current house.
Yeah.
Right here.
Yeah.
And then this is from this angle.
That's the front door.
So you really don't see another door right now.
No, I agree. I don't get that looking at the plans.
Yeah, you don't. Okay. So here.
Oh, okay.
Yep. So now their house is going to extend to here. This window is going to be their daughter's bedroom. So they're having.
This is the way the front is going to look.
Yeah.
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 And it is going to have.
That's the main front door.
Front door.
This is setback. This has a setback.
Oh,
it looks like it's up front, but it's really not.
Stairs going up. The door is going to go into the side?
No.
Okay. That's a door?
That's the door that will go into their house. So inside that door will be a mudroom and a half bath, and there'll be a door opening to get into their room. But on the inside, if I can draw it like this, or maybe see. And on this little porch here is a door here that you don't see.
Right.
That goes into the garage.
Okay.
Which gives us the way to go in.
Okay.
So there's no...
But it's still, and that's what I was getting at.
But, so there is a second door.
You still have two front doors on the house.
But it's like a side door. Like all these houses in Reading have, this does not have an in-law suite. So like this is just a connector with a little space there. That's the second door.
I've seen them, yes.
Like this, it's the same concept to actually add curb appeal. Because otherwise it would look like...
You have many houses have a front door,
right?
And then beside the garage, it's almost
a smaller entry right.
into the kitchen or the mudroom.
Correct. And we did that purposely because if we didn't, it would look like we were slapping an in-law suite on there, and it would look awkward.
Right.
So that adds more curb appeal, and it allows to take the same style of the home and continue it without it just being a garage.
It would be helpful if we had an architectural plan or rendering of that front showing that.
This is from the architect.
Okay.
3D.
Has that been submitted as part of your application?
Sure.
What you're going to have to do is convince the board that you do not have two front doors, that you do have a main entryway, and over here is just a side door.
Right. So do you understand that? On
I understand what you're saying, and I understand the concept, because I've seen it in many houses, but you have to convince the board.
Okay.
Because to me... You know, when I read subsection D here, this is what you have to do with your architectural plans.
Right. Okay.
So, you know, create a front door entrance, and that's just a side door.
Right, so it is drawn on the plans, though, that side door, their entryway.
Yeah.
Because if you look, it says entryway, covered porch, foyer, half bath, and that's all on the other side of the firewall.
Right.
So that's our livable space, so that door is entering ours.
But you don't have two houses.
Yeah.
Correct.
That's part of the point, right?
Exactly. Exactly. And that's what it says. If you have two entryways, you have two houses.
I look at this, you have the main house that's there now, and you're retaining that front door. Now you're building an addition and adding another front door.
So we can't have that door?
I don't know. You're going to have to convince us. And I know what you mean.
It's set back 17 feet, so we consider it the same.
I know what you mean. I've seen many garrisons.
It looks much better.
Yeah. I've seen many garrisons built that way with a front entrance, and then to the side, a mudroom entrance.
Right.
And there's two doors on the front. You're going to have to... That's why I say we need an architectural plan that shows this, a rendering, something that convinces them.
All right, let's have a timeout here for a second, okay? We have too many things going on at once. We're trying to maintain some semblance of order.
Okay.
Thank you. That's just been submitted. That was not part of the application package, but we'll take that into consideration. What's been discussed and what is being discussed is the requirements in the zoning bylaw regarding the appearance of the front of the residence with regard to entryways. And so we've seen the architectural 3D renderings. We've taken a look and having had some discussion back and forth going on at the same time, multitasking. The applicant should take away, you're looking for some things to take away? We would want to see the board would need to see a clear architectural drawing, plan and drawing that shows the location of those entryways clearly. They're not, that you can see just by the consternation of board members.
What's wrong with the front elevation?
What's that?
What's wrong with this elevation?
Yeah, they're in the plans.
What don't you see there?
There's a top-down view and there's a front view.
Well, I don't understand what you don't see.
That's fine, that's what you want to submit. That's what I'm getting at. I look at this, and I see two front doors.
That's a side door.
But that's a side door going into our...
Step back off the house.
Part of the house.
It's 17 feet set back.
That's your opinion.
Okay, then what is the subjective criteria then?
I look at it. My opinion, looking at the plans, unless I see something different, I see two front doors.
But we can't show you their door, and so that door is our mudroom entrance, essentially. So what are we supposed to show you, I guess, is what I'm asking. Because do those examples,
I think,
show you something similar to what we're going for?
No.
You know what I mean? Houses that have the side
I've seen it, yes.
Isn't that acceptable?
Yeah.
So how is that different than this?
The two front doors
or what I'm calling the two front doors.
Yeah.
The two doors that are on the front of the house that we see are actually going to the principal residence.
Yes.
Yes.
And those are, that is on the plan.
Okay.
Right.
Because it's on the first floor, and they do not, they will not be residing on the first floor.
Well, that's,
their entryway goes to the stairs to go up.
That's what I was trying to clarify. So that's, that goes to the principal residence.
Right.
Yes.
And the door to the accessory apartment is to the side.
Right. And,
and upstairs.
Right. And the square footage that that door connects to is our
So you
square
don't,
footage.
You do not see that door from the front.
No. Correct.
No.
No.
Correct.
No.
We knew we could not have that.
Right.
So we did not. Right.
That's why it's hard to see it. You can't see it.
Go ahead, John.
Okay, fair, fair.
Okay.
That's what we were getting.
Next
thing. Oh, well, all right. So you had something directly on point?
Yes. I'm sorry, I stepped in.
Yep.
There are 10, actually 11, but the 11th is a different, is a follow-up. There's 10 criteria for an accessory apartment that you listed, you went through when you were proposing all these plans of where the accessory apartment would be in conjunction with what you're going to build and what the existing structure is, which is the home there right now. So I think Bob brought up one of the areas that is different from accessory apartment than when the house was built, whether it was 20 years ago, whether it was 30 years ago, whether it was 120 years ago, you could have had, in essence, the equivalent of two front doors.
Mm-hmm.
Because that was then, this is now, and you're building an accessory apartment. When you build an accessory apartment onto it, you have certain criteria to meet, and those are in the criteria. Bob just hit on one of them. I'm just going to hit on the second one. And I had the discussion with the building inspector, and he couldn't come up with clarification on it for me. So I'm going to submit this to everybody here, including the other board members. In Part B of the criteria, an accessory apartment shall have a gross floor area not to exceed the lesser of 1,000 square feet or one-third of the gross floor area, and here's the rub, of the principal single-family dwelling on the lot. What is the principal single family dwelling of the lot? It is what you have there right now. So that is what is involved in my mind right now, unless we get cleared up. That's what the calculation for the accessory apartment size is restricted by. It's not that you can't add, build a new structure on the existing structure and then say I'm going to go back and I'm going to take my calculation on the resulting, because you just built upon something that's there. And made it a new dwelling before you ask for an accessory apartment. I agree with Bob and the rest of the board members, I think, and certainly our planning, our planners, and the changing of the zoning bylaws to allow multiple portions of the family to live in the same dwelling. However, to me, what this opens up, what you're asking for is, I want to take a small house, I want to build onto that small house, double the size, and then I want to take my calculations for my accessory apartment from the resulting double size, so my accessory apartment can be, in this case, up to 1,000 square feet, or as the building inspector had calculated, 960 square feet. So my problem is, in the wording,
what do you base the one-third on? Is it the existing residence as it exists today, prior to construction?
That's what it says.
Or is it the proposed new dwelling?
No.
It doesn't say original.
It doesn't
say existing.
Yeah,
I agree. It's just a principal residence, period.
We're discussing how we all view
and this is new. That's why we're going through this.
So
we get this in.
This is
new bylaw.
This is our first venture into this type of thing. So it doesn't come easy.
Mm.
But when it was changed, and it's been through a couple of changes. We were part of. It was changed to
not specifically, but generally allow this type of an application.
Right.
Because there are smaller homes in Reading that if you tried to squeeze an accessory apartment into the existing dwelling here, it would be a third of 1,600 square feet. Right. So while the bylaw was changed in essence not to encourage a proliferation of these type of applications, it was such that if you had a smaller structure and you made a bigger structure to add space both for yourself and for an accessory apartment, that the calculations would be based on the structure that was to be built.
Right.
Not the existing structure prior to. So that's why this is the new construction attached criteria in the table that the table that this section of the bylaw governs. If you go through it, this is attached new construction.
Right.
And so that's
but
why
that's,
they're here.
That's two steps. To me, that's two steps.
But you wouldn't have the accessory apartment without.
So what you're saying, I think,
is this.
I know what you think.
I know what you think because we talked about this on many issues when Zach was going through this. And we're taking lots that will accommodate this in town with small structures on it and allow you to take down small structures and basically build a two-family on a single-family residence. So you're in an S15 zone, and what you're actually creating is, as you mentioned yourself, two housing starts on the same lot.
Excuse me.
Sorry. On the same lot. So if you're going to do that, we'll have a proliferation of all these small lots with small houses on the lots that come in, and the problem is for somebody, whoever the policeman is, to determine what is a two-family and what is an accessory apartment, and how do I keep up with that, because the accessory apartment is governed by a different set of standards than a two-family is.
Mm-hmm.
So how does one do that? Well, we don't have the vehicle to do that right now in my mind. So what we're doing is we're creating, I know I'm going to get clobbered for saying this, we're creating a Somerville North in Reading. Everything is going to be two-family structures in S15 zone. If they were going to do that, the town planners probably ought to just go in and say, hey, look, let's have two-family zones created larger in the town and allow that to happen. But right now, if you want to do this, you could certainly come before the building inspector and ask for an increase of what you're asking for right now, except there's no accessory apartment in it. And then come back before the board and ask to create that, and the building inspector will probably tell you, put up the firewalls when you build it so that you can come back in and get the accessory apartment to
it. Right, so it seems like...
Again,
and that's just the way that my mind is focused on this right now versus what's going to happen down the line after this first case comes before the board. And I just throw it out there for discussion purposes.
We've discussed that.
You have.
Well, we have. We've discussed it as a board. We've discussed it as part of the zoning bylaw updates when we were going through them.
But not specifically this.
Well, and this is a case of first impression, I guess,
yes.
for this board,
okay.
Under that new iteration of the zoning bylaw. So,
okay.
So it's fair discussion. I'm not saying it's as unreasonable for discussion. I think the board, to the extent that we want to chime in on it, should. And I haven't forgotten about you, sir. Okay, I haven't forgotten about you. Go ahead, Robert.
I don't think we should be reading into what we think should happen, what could have been done, or anything. I think we should go to read into what the bylaw says, period. That's what we're voting on.
Mm-hmm.
To me, the bylaw is very specific, and it says principal dwelling. It doesn't say the existing dwelling, the dwelling that was there prior to any construction. It just says principal dwelling and accessory dwelling. That's it. The principal single-family dwelling in the lot, exclusive of any garage, et cetera, and accessory apartment. It doesn't say new construction. And it's like you say, John, they could come in and revamp their single family home and make it just as large as on the plan, and then come back and say, we're gonna carve it and we're gonna put an accessory apartment in. Doesn't make sense to do it in two separate steps to me. I mean, this is why we're here, for this accessory apartment.
That's why it's
bylaw.
New construction accessory apartment.
Now, if the town doesn't like it, because, you know, in your words, it's going to put two family homes in single family areas, well, then that's up to the town to come up with a different bylaw.
Judging by the fact that this is the first case we've had since this has been law.
We have a bylaw that we have to work with. That's,
you know, we have an obligation to enforce the bylaw.
Exactly. That's what we are.
And everything that they're doing thus far, minus some small things that we've already
discussed,
are,
I think so,
designed to comply with the subsections of that bylaw.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, we went a little bit out of order. Yeah. John.
I'll stop there.
No, okay, yeah, well, Robert, you were in the middle of discussion, comment portion.
I had two issues. Number one, when I went through it, was, and I had written notes to myself, needs to submit calculations in regards to the apartment and the principal structure. We need to come to a meeting of the minds of that, the town and the applicant. And number two, the entrance issue.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I know exactly what you're saying on the entrance. We're going to have to be convinced as a board that that's exactly what it is. The two entrances are for the principal structure. One is a secondary entrance to the kitchen, mudroom, etc. The other is to the main entrance to the dwelling.
Okay.
And those are the two issues that I had with it. Other than that, I had no other issues.
Thank you.
Can I just ask to clarify, when you say to document about the door, the second door, is it sufficient when you see the floor plan to see that it goes into
our side?
The house?
It's
on there.
You've pretty much committed to it already.
Thank you.
That's what I needed, and that's what I said. I wasn't against it, but I needed some clarification with the two doors.
What it's going
I originally
into.
Thought that new front door was going to the apartment.
Oh, yeah. No, it's not. It's going into
the That's
house.
The new front door for the principal residence.
Side door
and
the
old front door to the principal residence is now going to be the mudroom door, kitchen door.
Exactly.
Right.
And you'll see our bathroom and our living room through there
and
as
our
well.
Children.
Okay.
Yeah. Sir, you've been waiting patiently.
No, I just, I don't know whether it's a concern, because the lot that we're going to extend it to used to be a single lot. And back in the early 70s, I believe, the town said, it was a 10,000 square foot lot that we either had to build with, somebody had to sell it and build it for a house, or we had to give it up. Well, we didn't want to make that a single lot. I mean, you know, put a house there. I grew up in Revere. I didn't need that kind of closeness. You know, Somerville, Revere's the same thing. I didn't need that anymore. So we've decided that, you know, we just wanted to keep it as is, and we've done this until my daughter decided to come back in with her family. So we come to an agreement with this. What we want to do is just expand the house within the rules that the town existed. So
what he's trying to say is it's a 20,000 square foot lot.
Right.
It's not a
15,000.
I got what he's trying to say. They changed the lot designation.
Right.
They changed the zoning district.
It is a half acre lot.
Because when we bought it, it was like December '69. It was designated two $10,000. 10,000 square foot lots, two lots. And then something came up and said, well, that if maybe something to the effect, you'd either have to be, to maintain it being buildable, you'd have to do something. If not, it was going to be merged as one lot, one 20,000 square foot lot.
Yeah.
And he chose.
Gotcha. We understand.
Yeah. And believe me, that's exactly what the board is trying to do is, you know, you're allowed to do something that the town bylaws allow you to do.
Right. That's
and
saying.
We are just here to enforce the town bylaws.
Oh, we agree.
You
don't
meet all the
that.
Requirements. That's it. Whether we personally don't like something or not, that's out the window.
Yeah.
We have to go by the bylaws. Yes.
Yeah, and I just want to say, too, we're amenable to the bylaws, so anything that needs to be changed, we want this to go through. We want to be able to live with our children. We don't want to move out of Reading. We are happy where we are, and so now there is a bylaw for accessory apartments, so we're trying to abide by that. So we're willing to do whatever the criteria or stipulations would be. So that's what we're asking for your guidance, and you tell us if we're missing something and we have to check it off, then we're happy to adjust.
We're sure trying.
Okay.
Yeah. Robert, anything else?
No, that'd be.
Nick, anything else?
Yeah, I mean, just a brief comment. I mean, John, I kind of agree with you a little bit about, you know, there's a potential for degradation, you know, in the intention of this. You know, someone could come in and create a bigger single family, call it the principal residence, and then build the accessory. But just looking at the way it's written now, the zoning bylaws, you know, I think it's safe that what you're doing is okay, and there's no real way of stopping someone who wants to take it into two separate steps anyways. But I think I have every intention to believe that you guys can work with, you know, your engineer and build inspector and come back to us and good set of plans. And,
thank you.
Yeah, that's all.
I agree with everything that my fellow board members have discussed. The same issues are outliers to me. What I think I'll do then is there anybody in the audience that wants to speak to the application that hasn't already? Yes, sir. Please identify yourself and your address.
Mike Madeira, 313 Lowell Street. Welcome back. Nice to meet you. My only thing was, like, I got the letter. I saw the size, the proposed 36 by 46. Like, I was like, holy crap, this thing's huge. And so I haven't seen a plot plan. And so my biggest concern is if they comply with all the setbacks and lot coverages. And I think it's great that you guys are moving back. I'm all for it. I just want to make sure that it's not kind of exactly what you were talking about earlier, having a big structure randomly put and sort of having it ugly and sort of take away the value from the neighborhood. And then I'm also, the only reason why I'm here is because I'm concerned about turning into Somerville.
Thank you for your comments, sir.
But I guess I from what I understand is there's no issue with the setbacks.
No, we're staying all within all the areas. Yeah. And like we said, just to put your mind at ease, it is a two, it was originally, you know, all the capes are those small little plots.
Yeah,
we have a double one. So if you see, if you've driven by it, there's the arborvitae, which covers an entire second plot. So it should be proportional, just like the house across at the corner is a much larger house. They have a bigger plot. It's just not as typical on Lowell Street.
So I
don't want that either. And so that's why we worked really hard.
And it's set back 17 feet from the front of the existing house.
Hopefully give you enough space to turn around, too.
Yeah, right. So we did have to go back because we can't back out.
If there were, sir, if there were any indications that there were encroachments into a setback or lot coverage, they'd be applying for a variance, which they're not.
Okay.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah, no problem.
Right. Any other comments from members of the public? All right, we'll close the public portion of this down. So I think what we really need is a continuance for you to go get with the building inspector and get the material, identify at least the two issues, to come back to us with those two issues resolved and present them to the board so that we can vote on your application.
Thank you.
You agree?
The next hearing?
Let's see.
I just wanted to mention that we started this process in 2016 in May, if you'll see when the plot plan was done. And in the meantime, the bylaws have changed. And, I mean, we've been trying to do our due diligence. We had difficulty with an architect. It dragged out, went on. We've done what we can. We've tried to expedite this, but now we're talking 15 months. So every time is another delay, you know, it's making it longer. We're wondering, you know, seven of us have been living in that house. So we've been with three children.
An old Somerville saying, after a few days, even fish and company stink, right?
So we're just trying to expedite. So that's why, you know, as soon as we can get
going. We understand, but we want to make sure we want to get it right.
Yes,
okay?
I understand.
As you alluded to many times, we want to get it right.
Right.
The next available hearing date is July 20th.
And if you'd like to come back on that date, if you think you'll be able to get with Glenn and get all your ducks in a row by that date, we're happy to have you. Right now, there are no cases scheduled for that.
Exactly.
That night.
Is there anything else on that?
Nothing on that.
Nothing
night.
On the date.
Yeah, you'd be
okay.
The
no,
only
okay.
case on as we sit.
So as long as I get everything back to Glenn, by
get with Glenn.
Yep.
Talk to him about the issues that we brought up tonight, the calculations. You guys probably have to come.
Yep.
Eye to eye a little bit more.
Yeah.
You know, you're what 60 feet apart, something like that, as it stands right now. 40 feet apart. Something like that. 43. 40 square foot apart, something like that. And
keep in mind, you are going to need a recharge system for groundwater.
We have that. That was in there.
Pardon?
It's already designed.
Well, okay, fine.
No, we don't see it.
We don't see it.
We
don't approve
it.
Oh,
yeah,
but that will most likely be a condition that we put on it that you haven't approved.
Yes,
groundwater recharge system.
That was submitted, wasn't it?
Well, they wouldn't have that because we just got that we needed that. So
oh,
we
I'm sorry,
them.
Which, but it was submitted.
Which you'll need anyway for your building permit.
Right.
So.
Since you're on the books right now before this board, if there were any other zoning changes, you're covered.
Oh, that was my only other question.
It's not going to change next week.
It's not going to change, but if
the one
were going to change.
Oh, okay. Thank you for clarifying.
The application is in prior.
So we're like spinning our wheels trying to catch up to each
so
two.
We would need then a motion for to continue to July 20th.
So moved if the applicant is
in agreement to
agreement
the 20th?
To that, to July 20th.
We have a second?
Make that motion.
Second.
Thank you.
Okay, Cy. All those in favor? All right, your case is continued to July 20th.
Can I
thanks
just
for your time.
Clarify exactly what we need to come back with? We need the square footage with the correct 1/3
and
the fire
egress
in the proper place.
You need revised
drawings.
And
they need it on an official
revised
plan.
Drawings.
And that to be reflected on the drawings.
Right. On the plot plan? No, on the architectural
plan.
The architectural
well, frontage.
And do you need the recharge system as well up here? Do you need those?
No.
But
he's
we have,
saying you wouldn't be able to get
that
permit.
Right, we have it. Okay, but you don't need to see
it's
that.
It's approved by the town engineer and it's part of the building permit process.
Okay. Okay.
But we can reference it in our decision.
Okay.
Can
I clarify
one
other thing? If you vote in the next time, if we come back with the right calculations, that design and so forth, and are you then able to vote to give us permission to request a special permit? No?
Okay.
So your application before the board right now
is
for a special permit. The vote of this board eventually will be a vote whether to grant or not to grant the special permit application that you presented.
Okay. And then is it after that that the engineer, the town engineer, makes sure that we have the proper...
A condition of any approval,
yes,
and actually a condition of a building permit, more importantly,
yes,
would be approval of the town engineer for your recharge system.
Okay.
Yep.
Not part of this board. We would condition
good.
For it.
Oh, I
yeah.
see what
but
you mean.
But ultimately, the building inspector's already told you that. Mm.
They vote in good faith that stuff happens by the proper approvals.
Oh, okay. They would follow through with that aspect.
Or else it wouldn't be signed off.
I just want to be sure we're ready.
Yeah, or else it wouldn't be signed off as a little.
And technically the hearing's closed, I'm sorry. But we want you to get what you want. We think
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thanks for your patience.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
I have a little.
We'll see you on the
after the board votes.
Do you want to give those
days to
write it
out?
Yeah, give us your second set.
Appeal period that you have to wait before going. But at that time,
you
probably would have gotten an update on your request for the aquifer protection district.
From the town engineer.
And then you can go to the building permit. You'll be
inspector. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Pam, you're welcome. Have a nice night. I'm seeing you. Yes, I'll be here. Thanks
a lot. Yeah. Sure.
Still got it. How are you?
Hey,
Campbell.
When I get that, that's
all right.
All right. Try it. All right, so.
So now we're here for the continuation of case 1701. The continuation of the hearing on Reading Equitable Housing LLC seeking a comprehensive permit to develop 20 units of rental housing within an existing three-story brick building on a 45,779 square foot residentially zoned tract of land under Mass General Laws 40B 20 to 23 with waivers from zoning requirements on the property at 172 Woburn Street, Reading, Mass. All right, so we're here today to, I guess, solicit any further feedback from board members that have not had a chance yet to chime in on the record on the draft decision. You don't have anything new to submit, do you?
Nothing new.
That's what I figured. So at the last hearing, we gave the applicant some feedback on waivers. We went through some areas and gave town council, Chris's colleague, partner, Tom, a chance to go through and make those revisions. The revised draft decision was posted to the website that included those tweaks, if you will. And we're here to make sure that as we sit here today, there aren't, or to determine whether or not there are any other comments or anything that need to be brought to town council or the applicant's attention. Hearing none. I think the next thing we really need to do is just make sure we're ready to close the hearing, I guess. We've heard everything that we needed to hear. It's been a very collaborative process. We've gone back and forth. We've given our feedback. The applicant has worked with town council, town staff to make changes, to pretty much respond to the town's requests for changes in information, and we're happy about that. This has been a rather easy and smooth process compared to some others. So that said, Chris, anything I'm missing before we close the hearing?
I don't think so. I think we have all of the, substantive information about the project we need from the applicant, I think. I can't think of anything else that's outstanding. I have received some comments that are not yet incorporated into the draft from both the applicant and from MHP, which is the applicant's subsidizing agency. All of the comments I thought were helpful and useful for the decision. None of it really related to the details of the project. Some of it related to, some of it was just editorial and typo. Some of it was just had to do with sort of the affordability component of it. I think the only one change of actual substance was we had, in the draft that you have before you, I think there are three of the affordable units would be subject to the local preference, whereas the actual number is going to be two. And that's dictated by the state, not by us. And that had to do with, in an earlier draft, when we did the calculation, it was like 2.7 units. And I rounded up. The applicant at the time agreed that rounding up was the right thing to do. The state has, MHP has said that you round down. So it goes from three to two. That's out of our control. The number of affordable units remains the same. That is just the number of units that may be subject to a local preference. Three to two. That's it. So I've got some changes that I need to make to the decision based from what the applicant has provided and what MHP has provided. But again, those are not, those do not relate to the project itself. Just, you know, clean, I think, housekeeping and cleanup.
Okay. All right. Any other board members have any comment on what town council's just mentioned?
Good. One question. Who made the determination that it'd be 50% of the Boston AMI, not 80?
That was the applicant's.
Correct.
From the beginning. Okay.
Josh Latham for the applicant. That's actually the program that we're applying through. We go for 50% AMI. That requires 20% affordable units.
Okay. What program is that? Out of curiosity.
I'm sorry, I don't remember the name right now. I can definitely get that to you. It's in the package as well.
All right, great, thanks.
Anything else? All right, so we will, two things. Entertain a motion to close the hearing
And then we ought to, once we close the hearing, have a discussion as to when we as a board are going to meet to start the 40-day, you know, then the 40-day clock starts ticking. So then we want to...
That'll start ticking tonight.
Right, exactly. So we want to check our calendars perhaps over the next couple of weeks, maybe get together. You know, we can get a conference room like we did last time or wherever there's space available. Just to do whatever we need to do to hammer out the decision, which is pretty darn close. Maybe one more meeting might be needed at most.
I'd like to think it's awfully close, and that there's not a whole lot left to do.
Okay. All right. I will take a motion to close the hearing. John, do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Robert. Any discussion on closing the hearing on this 40B application? Hearing none. All those in favor? Opposed? Okay. We're closed.
All right.
No new evidence. Now, the next hearing date is July 20th, so we probably want to meet. Yeah, you know, we can pick a night. I mean, I suppose we could meet that night and have the first part of the be an open meet, open hearing, hear that case. Although, that night could fill up.
There is another application on Glenn's desk. He's going to be processing on Tuesday.
Okay.
I can have all of a new version of the decision with all of the changes that I think need to be made by early next week. So if we met, if the board met again on the 20th, you could have, you know, at least a week's lead time with what I would think of for my part as the final version of the decision. So you'd have that for a week before the 20th, roughly. Could look at it over the course of the week and get together on the 20th and see what we can do then.
So we may have two cases on that night. We have the continuance and perhaps another case that's on Glenn's desk right now.
How would we have another case if it hasn't been advertised yet?
I don't know that process. I just said there's an application on Glenn's desk. I don't know.
Yeah, so yeah, I don't think they'd be able to get to the 20th.
No,
okay. Well, yeah, they can publish it.
You need 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
Yeah.
2 weeks.
So yeah, they're cutting it close.
They can't,
yeah,
okay,
done.
That's good.
Yeah, they're done. Yeah,
okay.
They're done. All right, so we'll have one case on that night.
They would have had to have it in today.
Yeah, the continuance, and then we'll meet to discuss on the 20th. We'll have, you know, informal closed hearing on the night of the 20th.
The continuance.
After the continuance. All right? So we're good for the 20th.
Mm-hmm. Great.
All right. So thank you, everybody. We ought to have, while you're here, too. And I have them. So last time we were here, for the benefit of those that weren't here, we had a discussion regarding the Mullen rule. And those that have missed one of the hearings, well, while we're talking about this 40B, on this 40B must, in order to vote on the decision, presumably we're going to vote on this decision on the 20th, and we seem pretty confident that we'll have a pretty much done deal by then. Must, prior to that, watch the meeting that they missed and file the appropriate paperwork so it becomes part of the record. I have the forms here. The other caveat to that is, according to the Mullen rule, you can't miss more than one meeting ever and still vote. On that application and still vote on it. So, Si, you've missed two and will not be a voting member for purposes of the decision. Please chime in and offer your expertise and opinions, but you won't be voting on that decision. So the remaining 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 will, presuming you're sworn in and you get your Mullen rule stuff in. And you want to make sure you do that because we need all the members we can get.
Right.
To carry the hearing. So that said, I just want to, you know, make sure going forward that you have your Mullen rule up to snuff.
Thank you.
You need one?
You need one?
You need a copy.
Anybody else need one? Give me one.
All
right, get her done before the 20th, please, so that you can vote on the decision. All right? Thanks, everybody.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
This is the form you fill out when you miss something.
Thanks.
I thought I got it right, 8:15, but...
Oh, no.
You were here even early.
I left early. I was like, not getting any work done at the office. I figured I might as well come hang out with you guys.
Thanks for your help.
All right. Thank you all.
Do you guys need to vote on to continue that? You guys just said it. You guys are going to vote to continue it? Or are we just going
to... To continue what?
To the 20th.
There's no continuance. It's we don't need a continuance to...
It's
an informal
okay,
close the hearing.
Okay, so we're done. We don't
hearing's
have to...
Closed.
The hearing's closed.
Okay.
Scheduling, I mean, you're announcing a public session.
Yeah,
your
just...
next deliberation
yeah.
will be on
yeah.
the 20th.
Okay.
Yeah. Deliberation's on the 20th. Got
okay.
it. Thanks, Chris.
Thank you.
We need a motion for adjournment tonight, and...
Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Well, what about reconfiguration of the board? Do we need to do a new year on that? New chair, new vice chair, or at least vote for it. I don't know if we need new ones, but...
Do we do it every year?
I think we...
Not just every year.
We do it, or was it, every, or was it a... Do we
no,
do it every two?
No, it's every year. Every year. And
it ends up that those in the chair and vice chair position typically serve every two.
Two.
Serve
but
2 years. But that we vote every
yeah.
year
yeah.
to make sure that you still want it.
Yes.
All right. All right. Well, before we...
Do
so
we need
before
to
we adjourn,
for Kathleen,
Kathleen has resigned.
Oh, she has. I didn't realize
Kathleen
that.
Did not renew her position.
Yeah. Oh. Okay. So it's just six
yeah.
of us.
Kathleen
of
did not
right now.
Opted not to
okay.
to renew her.
So we have a full
membership.
Board. We could just
and so Eric will, if he hasn't, apply for the full
I
member.
You said you did.
The full member position.
What's that?
I thought you said you did.
No, I did the Mullen rule, but I so when I said I watched the video,
yeah.
I have not gone to the town clerk and said, sign me up for
no,
full membership.
All you need to do is go online and grab the application for the volunteer
okay.
application, fill
got
it out indicating your desire, you're a current member and you want to be up to full member.
Got it.
Send it to the town clerk, and they'll send it to the, whatever
selectmen.
It is, the appointment committee,
oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
so that
sure.
they can do what they need to do to up
sure.
you.
All right.
All right.
So even though you're an associate, it isn't automatic. You become a
you need to apply for the open
member,
position.
You need to apply for that.
I think it's probably a formality.
That's
when this committee was formed. Before that committee, it was all you had to do was to ask for that.
Right.
The selectman heard
yeah.
it. They said, "Yeah, you're already on the board."
I mean, when I came on, I was an associate. Obviously,
yeah.
the first few months or something. Then I think somebody did resign, and I became just okay. Now you're a full member.
I'll work out whatever we need to do, whatever the
yeah, no, the clerk
you,
told me what,
you,
the clerk advised you what you need to do, and Julie did,
yeah,
so you've got nothing else to do, right?
I mean, I'm here anyway, right?
Okay, I'll make a motion when we adjourn then.
Well, I thought we were going to do board organization.
Oh, okay.
Why don't we while we're here?
Might as well.
So I guess rather than, do we need to do a vote, or should we just... I'll stay on as chairman if
okay.
you'll have me.
I will nominate David as chairman again this year.
Okay. I guess we need a second.
Any other nominations?
Okay.
No, the nominations?
All right. Any other nominations? All right.
How about the vice chair?
Well, let's do the chair first.
Oh, one at a time?
Yeah.
Oh.
All those in favor is me continuing as chair for a year? All those opposed? All right. I didn't vote for myself. All right. And I'll nominate John as vice.
Vice chair.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All right.
Any further nominations?
Any further nominations for vice chair? Hearing none, vote for John as vice chair. Great. You're stuck here with me for another year. Congratulations. All right, motion to adjourn?
So moved. Oh, you did.
All right, Robert, second?
Second.
By Cy, all those in favor? We're adjourned. Thanks, everybody.
Crack your meeting.